Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò e benvenuto ad Alberto Angela che siamo ben contenti di ricevere qui. And now we're going to switch to English. I just wanted to give a welcome in our native language to Alberto, even if he's multilingual, but he studied in Paris and in the US, also took courses, and of course at the Università La Sapienza in Rome. We are very happy to have a chance to present Alberto Angela latest book in translation, that is The Reach of Rome, A Journey Through the Lands of the Ancient Empire Following the Coin. And here's a copy of the book, and as you have seen, we have copies upstairs for you to buy, and Alberto, will you sign them at the end of the conversation, hopefully?
No problem.
Alberto Angela is one of the best known public television figures in Italy. And I have to say that in the dark times of the decadence of television, hearing this little music and seeing Alberto's face on TV was a sort of a guarantee that what you... This was the la musica finale, no? La sigla. Something of really high quality. It's the trust that television is not only, as they say in Spanish, la caja tonta, the stupid box, but it can also actually provide some intelligent content, some educational content, some useful information. And Alberto Angela has basically done this in his life, trusting in the fact that that medium is not only the silly thing to enchant, and is, as in Italian we would say, instupidire the population. That was actually the origin of television in Italy when it was established. The idea was that television was done to educate. Non è mai troppo tardi, there was a very famous program in the 50s when they just started by Maestro Manzi that was Non è mai troppo tardi, it's never too late. And it really taught hundreds of thousands of Italians to read and write that did not know how to read and write. Then of course that was thought as paternalistic and old-fashioned. And so television became only a pure mean of entertainment at the lowest possible level. And that's why I think, as somebody who works for the promotion of Italian culture in this country, we are particularly grateful to what Alberto Angela has done, showing that television still can teach something, and can teach something in a manner that is entertaining, fun, and exciting. And for this, I would like to ask you to please welcome Alberto Angela.
Thank you very much, because you still don't know me, so just applaud eventually.
I think some of them know you. How many of you have seen any TV program with Alberto Angela before?
Not tutti.
And we're also especially grateful for those of you who have not seen a TV program with Alberto Angela and still came tonight to meet him and to listen to him talk about his book. As I mentioned, Alberto Angela is by training a paleontologist. So he studied really, really ancient stuff, and especially human paleontology has always been your interest. You published many books on paleontology and has done many TV programs on the origin of life, the origin of the human beings on Earth and so on and so forth. But more recently, you concentrated on ancient Rome. This is your third book about ancient Rome?
Second. The third will be kind of different.
But the second in English.
That's the second. The first one was a book that would introduce you to everyday's life in Rome, which is 24 hours in the great city, I mean the ancient city, following, you know, the Romans and their everyday life. And that was the first book I made. The second one is this one, Following a Coin, just like a guide through the Roman Empire. And the third one, which has not been translated yet in English, It's well, the title is Love and Sex in Rome.
I think when we present this book and Alberto's read an invitation, we will have problems with crowd control.
That's truly
provided we are able to send out an invitation with the word sex in the subject without going into the spam of everybody. The problem that we actually faced when we presented Isabella Rossellini's book, Green Porno. You cannot put porno in the subject of an email, otherwise...
We had the same problems when I was writing the book with the publisher. We would go back and forth, you know, and sometimes I couldn't find the things that would send me because...
Sex.
But let's say it's... we can say the real first Sex in the City. But it's no, I made that book. We're talking about a book that is not published in English yet, of course, but just to show that it is not what we think about Romans. Romans like to love life. And just to tell you that they would even, let's say, drink some perfume in order to have perfume kisses. So that tells you which was the level of loving in Rome 2,000 years ago. What you see in the movies and TV is not really what it was 2,000 years ago. So I wanted to write a book about how love was. I mean, if you would take some flowers, some red roses, were they a symbol of love? Would you take your date out of dinner at night? The answer is no, because you didn't have restaurants, you know, like this. You only had like saloons. But I mean, I wanted to explore this level of relationship between the Romans. After having gone the first on Rome, the second in empire, the third was a book in, let's say, the internal empire of the Romans. And with many, many, many surprises myself, I took all the news from the ancient books, from the ancient Marziale, Ovidio, and you discover, I discovered a world I didn't know. Although I feel like I'm an expert on Rome, but I discovered a totally new field, and I say people must know that. So that's the third book. We're going to find. The funny thing is that when I wrote, we were discussing about the title and with the publisher, my editor, and the problem was that if you put the word sex on the title, on the front page of the book, you won't sell it. Why? Because it won't make it from the shelf to the cashier. I mean, people don't want to show that they are buying a book on sex. I mean, they are kind of afraid. So maybe they're, you know, turning the pages in the library, but it won't make it outside the library. So that's why you always have titles like 50 and so on. Yeah, you never have sex. The word sex kills a book.
Do you know what? Do you have a contract for that book in the U.S. as well already?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Okay. We will translate it.
But the title in Italian is Amore e Sesso
dell'Antica Roma.
Dell'Antica Roma.
Yes.
Okay. We were too tempted to talk about that as a start. Not even available in it.
Especially when.
Allow me.
No, especially then we'll quit because there's another book. But when we're talking about Pompeii, I mean, people go to Pompeii just to see, you know, everyday's life, and then of course also the remnants of that terrible eruption, and also the houses where you have those drawings and having the paintings, and then you discover that there are so many paintings about love, and inside the houses, Romans would have paintings like we do. I mean, if you have a painting with a nude, it doesn't mean that, you know, it's a place where you going to have sex. It's just that it's a form of art. The Romans would have the same. So when you have to interpret a fresco that has been recently found, you always have to be careful about that aspect. And what happens is with that book, you understand how life in empire was, and it was just like our world. I guess that we would have seen so many familiar things 2,000 years ago. The way people would behave, the way they would like to to love life, really. They were enthusiasts of life and of love. And just imagine, and the Roman Empire is a place where you have one currency, one single currency, one single body of law, and there's a free market. I mean, you are in Libya, in Tripoli, or let's say in Alexandria, you can order in a bar the same kind of wine you can find in Rome or in London. Exactly the same things. If you watch your tunics, well, the tunics are a t-shirt, extra, extra large. It's almost, I mean, they invented it, I guess. And what happens is that the t-shirt, well, everything started maybe in Egypt with the linen that was grown in Egypt, and then everything, the fabric, I mean, the whole thing was made in Rome, and then it was sold in Spain, in Gaul, or in Germany. That's exactly what we have today with our shirts.
And the other remarkable things that kept the empire united, of course, was the language. And one of the questions I got from our friends on Facebook this morning, you know, we made a reminder that Alberto Angela would be with us, what would you ask him? And somebody asked, what was your relationship with Latin when you were in high school?
Very bad. Well, I went to a French school, and you had different sections, and my section was natural sciences. So Latin was not really something we would study a lot, and I would have liked to study more than that. I mean, I live in Rome, you see so many Latin signs, and you would like to interpret. Of course, knowing Italian and French, that helps a lot. But then you realize, and I realized it later, that if you want to read, let's say, the tomb stones or any kind of inscription, you not only need to know Latin, but you need to know the way they would write Latin on these places, on the temple.
Abbreviation.
Ooh, very difficult.
Sure.
Yes. So it's, I was, you know, relief. But no, just let me tell you that I started as a paleoanthropologist, that is someone who studies ancient fossils. I mean, the roots of humanity are fossilized ancestors. So for more than 10 years, a decade, I was digging in Africa, in Arabia, Mongolia, and other places. So I really didn't think about the Romans at all. But then I started to work on television just by chance, because I was invited in Switzerland for a series of programs, TV programs, dealing with the places I had been digging. For the digs, and they wanted me to tell them about, you know, human ancestors and so on. And they saw that I was able to speak fluently in front of the camera. So I say, they asked me, why don't you just write down a program about these things? You know, it could be interesting. So I wrote down a program, and I made it, and then it was on air. It went pretty well. And then in Italy, the whole series was bought and broadcasted. So I hadn't done anything in Italy, but I had been broadcasted. That time I started to work in television. My father works in television, that's why. And so we started to work together, and then it was split. I mean, we have different programs. But then, that's the key point, I started to do things about the Romans. I was in Italy. I was living in Rome. I knew Pompeii. I was not really fond of the Romans, but I knew that it was interesting to go and film, because when you are in Pompeii, you feel at home. If you go to, let's say, the Yucatan or in China, you will find fantastic things, but you won't feel that familiar. You feel like it's something different from what you think. You go to Pompeii, you get into the houses, you feel perfectly well. And you realize, you know, when you have, Pompeii is something absolutely amazing. It's a place that's been frozen. If you go in other places, like if you go to, say, even Ostia or Karnak, I mean, in other places, everything has been abandoned. So what you see are just ruins. In the Maya, the Incas, in Rome, I mean, Pompeii is different. You go there and you almost think that everybody has been, it's gone away for a while just to make you a joke. And you get inside, you see, let's say, a mirror still embedded in the wall, and you see yourself, your face reflected, and you think about what kind of person face was reflected in that wall, and the thing is, that's the emotional side. Then you have the rational side that start to work, and you say, wait a minute, this mirror is kind of very low, so they were not that tall. And you start to, yeah, of course, women were like 1.55 meters. I'm talking about meters, which is...
Yeah, I've been here for 24 years, I still remember.
So you will forgive him. Anyway, you will forgive me. And the man was...
25 feet.
It's about 20 centimeters less, no, that much less than me. That works. Yes. And if you are curious, you will find by yourself so many details that books don't tell you. If you go in any place, if you're curious, you will be the archaeologist. And you can ask yourself questions. You see, like, the step stone. To get into a house, and you see it, the grooves made by a door that's not there anymore. You see the place that is still living. And then, of course, you meet in Pompeii, the Romans themselves. What I don't like is that people take pictures, they have fun in front of people. These are not statues, these are people that are dying. They are frozen in the moment when they are dying. So we should pay them a lot of respect, my opinion, of course. But then, if you watch them, you see a person that didn't know that the American continent was there. He thought about Jupiter as a god, not as a planet, and also, I mean, and he would speak Latin. And here is a Roman. We're not, you know, everything that you read on the book stays in the book. But when you are in the field and you find yourself in the Roman world, you start reading, writing a book. So I wrote a book I would have liked to find in the shelves of the library, and I didn't find it, so I made it. And
another question about that, Alberto. There seems to be, and there's always been in Italy, a sort of a divorce between scholarly historical writing and divulgazione. And it was one of the problems that Indro Montanelli actually addressed when he was saying, In England and in the US, historians write in such a way that you can pick up a book, understand what they're saying, find it interesting, talk about it at a dinner table, and have a very exciting topic of conversation. Whereas in Italy, it seems that scholars talk to themselves, and there are other people that try to explain to the common reader, the educated reader, but not the specialist, what it is. So you're sort of trying to bridge, this is a more common book, I would say, in the American market, because the Anglo-Saxon tradition is in that direction, that there is scholarly and popularizing of the subject that are joined together. So you didn't find it in the shelves because of that reason. And I don't believe things have changed much since Montanelli pointed out that topic. And as you know, Montanelli wrote his own Storia d'Italia in many, many volumes, some co-written with other authors, but mostly by him. So that's why you didn't find this book on the shelves.
Yes. Unfortunately, what I feel is that we live, I mean, I live in Italy, and I feel there isn't a school of interpretation of all the sites. Myself, when I go and have to film some places for the TV, and I have to get information. The only information sometimes I found are books that thick, very technical. They don't tell you anything, and they're even wrong sometimes. So you really have to speak with the archaeologist or the scholar, and it's the human information, I would say, that gives you a lot. Because let me tell you an example. Just a few weeks ago, we were filming the wreck of a ship that was found not in the water, but let's say on land, because it went ashore. It was, a ghost ship dating back from Augustus' time that was stranded on the shore. It arrived, and no one knows what happened. We just know that that ship was full of goods. It arrived on the shore without anyone, and it slowly was covered by the sediments. So the archaeologists found it, because the sea by the time had retreated, run away. So it was a common dig, and they found so many things, even leather things. And so we went to film, and all this were put on two stories in a museum dedicated only on that ship in Comacchio, which is not too far from Venice, between Ferrara and Venice. So I was impressed by the things you would see, like amphoras, dishes, small temples, anything. But then I was intrigued by some shoes. Shoes left by some soldiers, legionaries. You can tell a sandal is from the military because it has some spikes, just like the football shoes, because it didn't have to slide on the battlefield. And that's typical. And so I said, well, okay, you know, I wouldn't say it's common, but you can find many places and remnants of shoes of legionaries. You can find it in the desert, in Scotland, in Germany. Many pieces have been found. Not too many, but some. But then we realized something, is that try to walk in the snow with the sandals, kind of freezing. And you ask yourself, how could they just, you know, walk in such a terrible climate? And the answer is, we don't know. Well, they probably have socks. You know? And so you've seen the movies and the reconstructions. Even people that know the subject would have, like, socks. And then, of course, by today's standards, having a sandal and a socks is not very beautiful, especially in Italy. But recently some...
We associate it to German fashion.
Yeah. Yes. but then you realize, say, wait a minute. Just imagine those soldiers marching in the snow or under the rain, in the mud. Would the socks protect you?
No.
And then we had the answer there. Along with the sandals, you had some, let's call that leather socks.
Like galoche?
Because galoche is outside.
Okay.
This, imagine some moccasin, kind of. Or going halfway up here, made of very thin leather. And so we found them inside the sandals. So we realized that the ship was stranded during winter time, first of all. And second, that this is actually the real, true soldier boot. If you think about today, you're in the same thing. These people had some, what is called socus, that was the name of those kind of leather boot, and the sandal that you would stride it around. So you had two things together. In summertime, you would only wear the sandal, so very practical. And the word socks comes from socus, which is actually this. So you see, we're not talking about things that are out of the world. But we were the first to see that. I mean, we, a filming crew. And we said, how is it possible that no one noticed that before? We were there with the superintendente, who agreed. I mean, we made an article out of that. And we said, well, we don't know. Well, the problem is that actually the whole thing has not been studied yet. It's been found 20 years ago. But no one has studied the pieces. Although these things are exhibited in a two-stories high museum. That's Italy. But that tells you what I told you before, is that you can find yourself in things. It's very interesting.
It's like a re-embodiment of the so-called history of material culture. And there are many occurrences in your book in which you concentrate on a detail, on an object, on something that has been found. And around that, you build a beautiful story. And as you mentioned also in your introduction, not all these stories are true, but they're all plausible. And it's a beautiful thing that you start with the object, an object that we might see in a museum or in an archaeological site, and really give life to that object and give life to the people who use that object. That's one of the very important characteristics of this book, like picking something, an object, and like you did now with the socos, bringing us alive and making us understand also the life of the people who wore them. Your book takes place at the time of the ritual Rome, of Emperor Trajan, and also the emperor himself makes a sort of cameo apparition in the book. Why Rome at the time of Trajan? Hadrian, who came immediately after him, received much better press. He's considered much more interesting from your snap on, but you decided to concentrate on the Rome of Trajan. Why this choice?
Well, probably if your sonar hadn't lived, probably Adrian wouldn't be that famous. No, I'm kidding. But it's there is like a boundary in Roman history, and that's exactly the boundary between Trajan, and Adrian, my opinion. Because what you see with Trajan is that he did two, three things. He was, when he came into power, is actually he was a general, he was a commander. He was not a politician, he was a soldier. He was at the head of the legions up north in Germany. And when he was nominated emperor, he didn't come to Rome. He stayed for a year because he had a duty to finish. He had to fortify, to give strength to the limes, the frontier, the boundaries of the empire. And on the way to Rome, he stopped to the borders of Romania, what is called today Romania. At that time, it was called Dacia. And it was the kingdom of a very, very smart and dangerous king, the Chebos. And he stopped there just to say, look, you're going to be next. Came to Rome, and he was unknown. He didn't have the safes of the Roman government were totally empty, and no one knew him. And he had to do something to be known and to help. I mean, he wanted to help the Roman Empire. So he made like two big campaigns against the Dacia, basically because you had some gold mines. And that was also...
How was the emperor selected at this time, since you said he came back to Rome and nobody really knew who he was? Who picked him as
emperor? Well, the former emperor would tell everyone that would be the next one. It was not... You had different way of doing that. Sometimes the Flavians, like Vespasiano, and then Tito and Domitiano, that was like a hierarchy made inside the family. But in other places, the times, it would be different. It would be the emperor choosing
his successor.
And that's exactly what Trajan did. Adrian came back. Before, I mean, you had first Nerva, who was an emperor for a year, and he was afraid about the Praetorians. So he said, look, the next one is the chief of the legions in the north, so stay calm. That's the reason of the choice. But then he died pretty soon. So Trajan, who didn't have absolutely knowledge about the courts of Rome, if you think about the movie Gladiator, you have more or less the idea of what a soldier was. He was very good in fighting, the enemy. But the enemy behind you is a kind of different enemy. So he was a very nice person. He would sit in the Circus Maximus among the people, ordinary people, to watch chariots races. He made a fund to help young boys and young girls using his own money, United States money. He was a very, very warm and direct man. And no one remembers him for that, but he made something else. He was the one who extended the Roman Empire from Scotland to Iran. What you see today in history books is exactly what he did. Adrian shrunk the whole thing back to Jordany, and then he put up the famous Adrian's Wall in Scotland. It was just like switching off the engines of the Roman Empire. From that time on, you're not aggressive, you're not strong, you wait for the barbarians to come. That's my opinion, of course. But that is what I believe. He had an idea of globalization, which is extraordinary. For instance, he made a war in Iraq. He actually invaded Mesopotamia. It's exactly what happened a few years ago. But on the other side, from north, not from south. Why? He did that because he wanted to create a channel, a corridor between India and China and the Mediterranean markets. So that's a very, very modern way of thinking. Another thing he did was, and he succeeded, he went all the way down to Kuwait. You had a Roman emperor watching the Gulf Sea, seeing that vessel going to India, that's what we know about. And he told, well, I'm too old to do what Alexander the Great did. He actually died a few months later. But you see, he was a modern way, a modern man, a modern way of thinking. Another thing he did was he sent a legion in the desert in Algeria to build a city right in the desert. Well, not in the sands, let's say in a very dry area. Now, if you watch all the important cities and towns in Roman area, I mean Roman town, you will find them along the coast or, you know, along trading lines, along the rivers, the roads. But what was the reason to build a city in the desert? And that's been puzzling for years, the archaeologists. Just imagine Pompeii, a perfect Roman-style city with all the square blocks, you know, and then the different streets. And they didn't know until they started counting the seats in the theater, and they realized the real reason. You had a gigantic theater that could almost host maybe twice the inhabitants. So they realized that the whole thing was made not only for the people living in the city, but also for the people living in the whole area. So the idea was, he sent a legion to build a city to show the Roman way of life to all the people around. People that were in a very dry area. Well, if you go into the city, you can see fountains, thermos, because the Romans know how to find the water, how to channel it to the town. You see markets, you see goods you would never see in your life, because trading takes goods from all over Europe and the Mediterranean Sea, even silk from China. Just imagine being a shepherd in Algeria. Deep in Algeria, and you see silt. What is that? Okay, we're talking about 2,000 years ago. And then he actually conquered the whole area just by showing the way of living at that time, which is very similar to what happens today.
And talking about, so the maximum extension of the Roman Empire takes place under Trajan, and that's also the highest peak in the conquest. And talking about Africa, staying to what you're saying, your chapter on Africa is called An Empire Without Racism. Aren't you idealizing?
No, really. The funny thing, the good thing about the Roman Empire is that it's a reflection of our world. You see the same world built 2,000 years ago, and it has the same structure. I mean, it looks like humans have a pattern of doing things. Same problems. We can talk about the problem in Rome were exactly the ones you see here in New York. Exactly the same. Traffic, the flats and the apartments would be four times more expensive than outside and so on. And exactly the same thing. And then skyscrapers too. So racism, which is interesting. If you watch the Roman era, the Roman times, you see the same problems and their solutions. You see what solutions they found for, let's say, the religious problem and the racism problem. And what I can say is that no one in the Roman time, the Roman Empire, had ever been, let's say, put in jail or criticized or anything happened to him for the color of his skin. Absolutely. It's just as if today you would think that someone is discriminated for the colors of the eye. Say, no. That doesn't happen. Why? Because the Romans were very pragmatical, very practical people. So they say, as long as you follow the rules, there's no problem. Look, one of the most successful emperors during Roman time is called Septimius Severus. And he reigned 100 years later. And he was one of the best, but he was coming from Libya. He was a Punic. He was the descendant of the typical, the most famous enemies of Rome. Hannibal was Punic. But he had become a Roman emperor. Why? Because the Romans said, look, you are my enemy. If I conquer you, your son, maybe not you, but your son, can become even a Roman citizen. And once you have the citizenship, you have all the way freed. You can become even an emperor. And if you watch, what is interesting is that if you watch Septimius Severus, he had a dark skin. He was the Obama of that time. Absolutely, absolutely. And another thing is that if you think about other empires, like the English Empire or the French Empire, no inhabitant of New Delhi or Nairobi could become an emperor in England, or the same, a Polynesian becoming an emperor in Versailles. This was absolutely nonsense. That is a mistake that was made. If the Roman Empire and the Roman era had such a long time, because it opened itself to other peoples. It was just like a koine. You had different people, different way of thinking, but only one law. So it was a multi-ethnic society, but not a multicultural society. Multicultural society, I'll tell you, is the airport. That's the multicultural. But you need common rules.
Anyway, for example, they allowed to keep to all the people they conquered to keep their religion and to keep their traditions as long as they didn't contrast with the Roman laws.
Absolutely. They said, look, you can believe what you want as long as you recognize the emperor as a divine figure. I mean, is the number one. That is the way. But if you think anyone that wants to become a citizenship in Italy or in the United States has to swear that he will follow the constitution. I mean, the laws. That's exactly what the Romans were asking. They say, by doing only by time to time a little sacrifice on an altar to worship the emperor, so you would publicly recognize his divine figure, you're part of the team. We don't ask you anything else. So you did. If you go to Ostia is an incredible city. If you didn't have Pompeii, everyone would go to Ostia. You have four-story buildings still there. That's the only place on Earth in which you can see an insula, let's say a big building from Roman times. You have anything from pyramids to underground temples, everything. And you have different temples. You have a temple, the oldest European synagogue, not too far away from a Persian temple. So at that time, you didn't have religious problems between two communities that would live all together without any problem. Of course, you would have problems if someone would not respect that order. And the Romans were really strong, no mercy in that case.
And that's the trouble that started with the Christians that could not accept to recognize the divine nature of the emperor.
The Hebraic world at that time.
With the Jews, yes.
What I felt is that we cannot idealize that world, because it was a world far different from us. You had slaves.
Tell us something about the slaves, because you devoted a rather important part of your book to slavery and the slave trade and the reputation that the mangos, they were called, the slave traders had, and the tricks that they did to import illegally the slaves. So there was indeed slavery. It was a big part of Rome.
Yeah.
The percentage of the slave population in Rome per se was staggering. Okay. But where were they coming from? You said there was no problem of the color of the skin. It was not a racial thing that you would enslave a certain ethnicity. Who were the slaves in Rome? Where did they come from? What were their living conditions? Were they treated better or worse than the slaves in the United States?
Here again, we have like many ideas in our mind due to movies and novels. Well, it is what you think, and it is not what you think. It's everything together. Let me start from a skeleton that was found not too far away from Rome, at the outskirts of Rome, suburbia. It was the skeleton of a very young boy who had brain surgery. We can tell that because we can see a hole still in his skull, and he died. He died, but not due to the surgery itself. He died due to the problem he had, like he had a brain tumor that was expanding, and he had a problem for that. So the surgeons and the doctors were highly skilled at the time, were able to relieve depression by opening it, which is still today the same technique that is used many times. So, but the problem is that there was a very, very expensive surgery, but the young boy was a slave. And that tells you something. Probably his owner, his patrician, it was a patrician, rich patrician, paid for what was considered at that time one of the most difficult and expensive surgery. And so that tells you something, is that it is not true that people were, you know, were very aggressive and violent towards the slaves. You had like an area of, say, they could come as someone from the family. I mean, if you think about movies, let's go with movie. Gone with the Wind, the most recent Django, tells you, give you some perspective in different times. Mm-hmm. And you see some slaves that are part of the family, especially the mama in the Gone with the Wind, which is absolutely what happened in the Roman times. You, if you were a patrician, you would make your children educated by a slave, a Greek slave. That was their school. So by the term of slaves, you actually have a whole category of people going from the people working in the countryside. That was the worst kind of slavery. It was just like in the mines. To the city slaves, to the, let's say, the common slaves you would have at home. And you would have it.
But that's where did they come from?
These were usually prisoners for. They were some children of other slaves. We found terrible the fact that an owner could sell the children of his own slaves, but we do the same with our dogs and cats. Exactly. So if you want to get inside the mind of a Roman, I'm not saying he's doing something right, I'm just trying to understand that.
The mindset, yes.
You have to think that they consider the slaves basically, or someone from the family, which is okay, or some machine, some electronic device, something you have at home. People had, at that time, say a wealthy family would have, not a super rich, but say a wealthy family would have like something like 10, 15 slaves at home. They would sleep on the floor, just like our dogs. And interesting to see that you had some markets of slaves, exactly like, and people would go there and say, hey, say like just like the washing machine that's broken, you have to find a new one, and the costs are different, it's very expensive. That's what they were thinking. Of course, it's horrifying for a time, but for their time, it was normal. So if you think about how many automatic things you have at home, from the lighting, to the water, to, let's say, the washing machine, to the oven, everything, and you start to count, you will get to 10, 15. And that's exactly what the rich Roman had. But we know that even the poor had slaves. It was just like a hierarchy of slaves, and you would own their lives. You could do whatever you wanted. Of course, you had some restrictions, but let's say gladiators were slaves. They were, their lives was owned by what is called an editor, or let's say the organizer of the games,
manager.
The manager, yes. So it was a very complicated and structured, straight up the civilization, Roman civilization. But it was an extremely important part of the Roman society because these were the people working everywhere, but also they could be freed. And once they were freed, you had some owners that would marry a slave. In Pompeii, a bracelet, a golden bracelet made with the shape of a snake was found, and inside there was a writing, and it's actually from the owner to her slave. And obviously, she was not slave anymore. He would never give her as a slave such a gift. And you have, at that time, the possibility to free a slave. And that was the new blood for the Roman society, because during Roman times, you had decrees of birth decrees, and even a decrease of marriages. So you had a demographic problem, exactly what we are experiencing today. And they opened, let's say, the gates for the slavery to have new blood for the Roman society.
And it is more or less at this time, you know, with the maximum expansion of the empire, where you have the massive phenomenon of liberation of slaves, the so-called liberti, and they become this crucial class, and they have civil rights, right? They can inherit, they can buy, they can sell, they can own, they can marry, but they do not exercise political power.
They don't have
power. They have no access to.
Yes, and if you read the accounting of the ancients, like 1,000 years ago, and so on, you realize that the worst that a slave could have, he is being owned by an ex-slave. The Roman could be very aggressive, very violent, but an ex-slave, what is called liberto, was terrible against the other slave, which is a horrible thing.
We have a glimpse of that in Trimalchio, the character from Satyricon, who is a freed slave.
So anything you see in the movies, I mean, that's the perspective, is true. And that is it. But also, you had, let's go to the everyday's life. How could you become a slave? Well, you could be, if you were, for instance, you had to give money to someone, and this guy could sell you to someone else. Of course, you were still a Roman citizen, so you were like an in-between here. But it is interesting to see that even the Roman citizens could be captured and transformed illegally into slaves. Because in the countryside, the big farms needed to have working hands, and by time to time they would kidnap people along the road, even Roman citizens, that would disappear. We know from Adrian's time that the army itself would raid into those farms to free common people. And another story is the one about there was like a baker, a big bakery in Rome, and they would kidnap people by time to time. And it happened that they tried to kidnap a soldier who defended himself with his sword and killed everyone. And that's why you realized that was a problem. So you see, this is, yes, a problem with, let's say, everyday life. But life in the city, life in the streets, was not that violent, as you can see, for instance, in Renaissance time or the Middle Age. If you go into that time, think about D'Artagnan. Think about the fact that anytime you have a problem, boom, you take a sword out or a knife, and you solve the problem. During Roman times, absolutely not. It was forbidden to go around with weapons. Now, if you go to Ercolano, Ercolano is the second city killed by the volcano, and the archaeologists found, at the beginning of the diggings, no corpse. Only a few of them, you know, like an old man on a bed, things like that, like a little baby in a crash, but nothing more than that. But then, so they realized that everyone had fled, that they saved themselves. But then they went all the way down the city, when they explored it, they arrived on the seashore, and they found in the arches, where you usually put the fishing boats, they found 300 skeletons. They were passing the night waiting for rescue for the following morning. But during nighttime, you had an avalanche of gases and high speed and high temperatures that killed them. The skulls themselves exploded in many, many. You had like an oven effect inside this garage, so to speak. And then 300 people that were fleeing away, trying to escape in such a difficult time. And you had money on you, you had nickels, rings, it was a good thing to have a weapon, a knife, one never knows it. Well, among 300 people, only one person had a sword, and he was a legionary, a soldier. So yeah, he was allowed to have it. So that tells you that during Roman time, and also Greek times, the law was very important. You would have a problem, you go to the to the judge. The only problem is that you didn't have investigations. You didn't have, any
detectives.
Yes. You had to find the proofs by yourself, and then your lawyer would do, you know, the things. and it's famous, the fact that in the forum you would have all those processes, those courts with those lawyers shouting.
A very theatrical.
Oh yeah, just a TV
like
thing.
Going to see a performance. Yeah.
Right? Absolutely.
Like it's still now in Naples, for example.
Yeah, yeah. Not only Naples, all Italy, I would say.
I would like also to open the floor at some point, but first I wanted to read you some of the subtitles of Alberto Angela's book, just to give you a sense of what you will find in it. So it is Rome, of course, where it all begins. London, and Roman inventions. Paris, when it was smaller than Pompeii. Trier, making the nectar of the god. For example, there is Milan, women's liberation. We have to go back to that. And Reggio Emilia, humor, seduction, and adultery. Rimini, a delicate operation. We return to Rome. We have Circus Maximus, The Secret of Ben-Hur. And then we have, for example, Baia, Luxury and Licentiousness, maybe a little anticipation of your third Roman book. What I quoted already, African Empire Without Racism, India Beyond the Borders of the Empire, and so on and so forth. Tell me something, why you associate women with Milan, with women's liberation, and what was the condition of women in ancient Rome at this time?
Yeah, well, the problem is that the coin is getting to Milan. It's not my fault. It's just
you know, the story, as I mentioned at the beginning, is these sesterces. That is a coin, approximately 50 cents of it.
A sesterce is about $3. It's $3. You could buy a good glass of wine or a bottle of very bad wine. But if you, there is, it's interesting to
in Italy, here even a glass of red wine is $8.
But it's interesting to see how can you just tell the value of that. Well, because you know, by the writings on Pompeius' walls and by Martial Marziale, that tells you some by time to time the prices of slaves or anything, so you can more or less have an idea of the value of a sesterce. And the Romans had a golden coin called aureus, and then denarium, that is the silver coin, and then you go all the way to bronze coin, and then copper coins and so on. So they have a precise hierarchy of coins. And I chose the sesterce because it was a very common. It was just like a, let's say, $5 bill, more or less, at least $3. And so it would pass from one end to the other. So in that book, everyone has truly existed, because I meant it. I said, okay, this is the time during Emperor Trajan, 115, okay, Anno Domini, after Christ. And the coins would go in that place or the other, and then and so I went to find people that really exist in that area, from tombstones, any kind of inscription, knowing in some times I can even know their face. You can even see their face, because especially in Egypt, you could see the face. I mean, they had their pictures hanging on the wall of their houses, and then when they would die and they would be mummified, even though they were Romans, they would put their picture on
the portrait on the
chest. And these are the famous Fayum portraits. You have hundreds. And when you watch these portraits and you say, hey, this guy looks like my neighbor, this one, oh, this is a gas station man. You know, just the same people. One looks like, very much like Sylvester Stallone. Just the idea was to be as true as possible. So in few cases, I was not possible to find the person that I wanted. I mean, I knew other, you know, the names, yes, you can find in Spain and Northern Africa, but I wanted a specific one. One was the a singer, a female singer from Hungary. She actually lived a little later, like a few decades later, but it's okay. I mean, I imagine that someone like her existed at that time. So sometimes, yeah. What is interesting is, not going back to the question, is that the coin itself is actually an excuse. It's just like a flying carpet that passes from one city to the other, from one hand to the other, explaining you the places. And these are almost, all of them are places that I saw. I went to film, so I can tell you really everything about that place, thanks to the scholars and the archaeologists, but even the weather. If it's chilly, what is the angle of the lights, let's say in Libya or in Alexandria. Even, let's say, if you go to, the coin will go all the way to Luxor, where today you have the Pharaoh's tombs, and then it goes to India, because the Roman knew India very well, they were trading with India, there's no problem. But in the Pharaoh's tombs, the scholars, I mean the archaeologists, found some Roman graffitos, not inscriptions, graffitos, made by tourists. So at that time you had tourists as well. And one would say, hey, what a beautiful place, incredible, look at the color. Another one would say, I cannot understand the hieroglyphs. I would like to understand that, but I don't understand. And the third one wrote, does your mother know you're here? But then also that those human, let's say, aspect of the Romans is found in the tombstones. Tombstones are something that helps you to make, just like a spoon reaver approach to the Roman times. Mm-hmm. And I remember many would tell you they were trying to understand the meaning of life. They did not believe in afterlife. They said everything is here now, so have fun. And they were living much less than us, 41 years a man, 29 a woman, statistically, of course. Which Roman would have come here, he would have told us, look, I don't care about the airplanes or the electricity. What I care about is that you live twice as me. And it's just as if you would meet someone who would live 200 years. That is something fascinating. So you have in the tombs those, let's say, this approach, very interesting approach. And it actually, if you see today the graves, you see a tombstone made by the living towards the dead, saying some loving words towards the dead. And the cemetery is somewhat out of the town. It's not in the living world of the living people. It's like a separate area. When you go anymore, you're dead. In Roman time, it was exactly the opposite. You would have, well, you were not allowed to bury people inside the city. And Julius Caesar, who was cremated in the photo, was an exception. But you would have all the graves along the road that would lead to the town, outside the boundaries of the city. You would have, just like advertisement, hundreds of tombs and monuments and tombstones that they were actually the dead talking to the living people walking by. And someone would start to say, hey, stop walking, stop here. Okay, I want to tell you something. And you had a lot of, let's say, suggestion about life. They say, have fun, because here where I am, it's all dark and cold and so on. And then you would find even medical malpractice. I was killed by the
doctor so-and-so.
But not the name. But there is something which is interesting, is that you can even find humoristic tombstone. Just like someone saying, well, have free lodging for the rest of my life, I mean for the rest of the time, and because money was a problem. And then you had that actor who said, many times I've been playing this role, but never as well as today. Well, you see, so you find life. So the coin itself is a symbol of that world. But if you think about our money, you will find, let's say, coin with on one side the face of a person who is important in our society, in England, in France, in Italy, or we have euros, which is a different thing. But in Roman times, the sestertio had the same thing. Yeah, the face of the emperor always facing right. He was well dressed, showing himself as being the protector, the soldier of the Roman laws, constitution, and way of living, reassuring who was watching, so to say, hey, we're here. But then on the other side, you would flip the coin, and you would see something he had done, a new moment, a victory, or symbol of wealth, symbol of something, showing we're fine, saying we're fine. So you understand that the coin had not only a financial and economical objective, it was actually a propaganda, a mediatic tool. They didn't have television, they didn't have radio, but you remember an American president sitting and speaking at the radio to the nation? Well, the Romans would do the same with the coins. Anytime something would happen, make a new coin, and then in a matter of a few hours, you would have those coins being sent in the four corners of the empire to tell something to the people. And it's interesting that you had the same laws of media, or media, I should say, because media is a Latin word. And nothing has changed. And by the time, for instance, when emperor would die, the next one decided in a matter of, a few hours sometimes, would order new coin being made, and the expert of coins and numismatics can tell you that, because if you watch his portrait, it's exactly the same of the other, the one before him. They made only a few differences, just to say, okay, there is a new one. They use like Photoshop, kind of. Just to see, but you know, the message was, we have a new emperor, and that's his face. So anyone would be reassured.
The women.
Okay.
Milan, liberation.
I tried to avoid that, but.
No, we have. Look how many ladies we have.
To understand the woman's situation in the Roman Empire, you have to go back before the Roman Empire. During Julius Caesar, Augustus, a little earlier than that, during Sylla era, there was a problem. You had civil wars. And with these civil wars, many very rich, important Romans had been killed. Killed directly because they were enemies, or indirectly with those famous proscription list. What that mean? You had Sylla, who was in charge. He would put a list in the forum, say, these are enemies. I want them to be killed. I mean, I want their body, live or dead. These are enemies. So anyone could kill them. By doing so, you had a lot of patricians being killed. And where would their money, their property go? Well, if they had some son, the son would inherit, but their wives or their daughters were not able by law to inherit that money. I mean, they would formally maybe inherit that, but our males would handle and use that money. And the Senate understood that that was a problem. So they made a new law on which they said women can handle money, can use money, can do just what men are doing. And that changed totally the Roman society. Women started to gain power. They were able to divorce like this with a man. And they became more and more important and more, equal to men. So you had a women emancipation. You had the same situation of women that you have today during Roman times. You have never had that before and later. Only those two times in human history you have the woman emancipated and free. Roman times.
Through economic power, basically.
Yes.
By creating the masses.
That was the first. That was the mechanism. Tell me that. And that's why, I tell you, an archaeologist told me, that if you want to see also the freedom in a society, you also, the good way is to watch all the erotic drawings. Positions and behaviors tell you a lot about the position and this is true. If you watch the Romans and you see what's even a woman above a man, which is absolutely unbelievable for a Roman standard or in other, let's say, societies. So the women had the possibility to inherit. They were absolutely powerful as powerful as men, as protected as men. But they were not able to go very up in power. You never had an emperor or a senator woman, because the Roman society was a man-ruled society, full stop. That was something that never changed. But in everyday life,
men know that determined basically who would become an emperor. So they exercised some sort of parallel power in.
As we know, let me tell you one thing. Once I went to film some Viking sites in Norway. And we had, you know, the reconstruction of the dressing of how the Vikings would go around dressed. And one thing I was impressed about is that the women had a key hanging on. And say, what is the key for? Well, it's the key of the safe. I mean, of the. Mm-hmm. Why? Because it's the woman that rules. Even during Viking times, you know, these people were just cutting into her head with an axe of the enemy, but inside their huts or their house, the woman would rule. And that has been true for everyone. There is a saying, Italian saying, many of you may know, who say that is in the home is the woman that wears the trousers. That's typical, you know, just to say that actually she is the core of the family, of the house. But it's interesting to see that divorce in Roman times was very easy. A woman could divorce from a man. not only a man for a woman, but a woman for a man. And you only need to have no lawyers, no nothing, very easy. In front of some witnesses, let's say at a banquet, six person, that was enough to say, I don't want to stay with that person anymore. Bang, everything, full stop, that's it. But then you could remarry again, and so you have people that, I guess, Catone Uticense, he's a guy who divorced from his wife and married with a young lady, and his wife married an old man, very rich man, who died. So she inherited a lot of money, and Catone married her again. What tells you is that, and that's the topic of the second, of the third book, is that the key point of men and women's relationship in Roman times was that you didn't have love in the marriages. No marriage was based upon love, very seldom. Usually, is just what you see in many countries today, the families decide when there are still kids who is going to be married with who. They kind of marry power, more or less, because Roman society is based on power and money. So it's not, that's why you don't have racism. Racism would be something that would disrupt this mechanism. So you would have a woman and a man marrying, finding themselves married, seeing each other maybe the first time during the wedding, which is terrible. For the first night, the woman, there was a long ceremony and everything, but then the woman would stay alone in a room on a bed, and you would have a slave, a woman slave, coming and taking away everything, like pins, necklace, anything that could hurt the man, because the first night was actually a rape. Because they didn't know each other, there was no love at all. So she would have to do babies. So, woman was a liberated woman by, let's say, ancient time standards, not today's standards, of course, or our society at least. But then, there are things very strange happening. Let's say at a banquet, you would have a man saying to his friend, look, you don't have children? Well, my wife is very good at making children. Why don't you take her? Well, in 3 years, then you give me back my wife, just as if you would lend something. And
of course a woman could not do that with her husband.
Nobody.
Lending to a friend of hers.
Usually not. But if you ask a woman at that time, how many men did you have? I mean, how many married men did you have? She would say, my husband or even other women's husband. Because it was, if you understand that situation, you understand how everything was working. And that is very interesting. If you read Ovidio gives you, a sight of the relationship between men and women that is exciting.
Exhilarating.
Yes. Yeah. And he was exiled at the very end because he had some strange affair with the daughter of Augustus. So it was bad. I imagine Ovidio being just like a Clooney, George Clooney of that time. Very handsome, knowing everything about, making love or courting the girls. He wrote a book in which you can see, he tells you where to find, to court women in Rome, which are the best places and the techniques also to approach a woman, which is interesting. Because one of the things said, for instance, you go to the Circus Maximus. Well, let me tell you. In the Colosseum, men and women would be separated. Women in the top, men. So there would be a distinction in seats. In the theaters, the same. But the theaters, as Ovidio said, was a place where women would really love to go because they wanted to see and be seen. And that was a place where you would look at someone and understand. It was just like giving the number, private number, name, and everything. It was just like this. But in the Circus Maximus, that's where you had the races of horses, the charioteers, the races. The public was mixed. So you would have a physical contact with a woman. And he would say, look, you go there, you just pinpoint the right woman, the right girl, you sit close to her, you start to be very nice with her, just ask her, what is the horse she likes most? I mean, what's her team? And of course, it's going to be your team as well, and you're going to be very nice with her. At a certain time, you would say there is even the psychologists tell you that there is a key moment when there is like a physical contact between the two persons, and that contact was that inventing an excuse like. There would be some dust on the dress. You would take away the dust, or of course, would kind of see by yourself. But then the other thing is that pretending that her robe would be under her sandal, they say, "Can you just lift out a little bit your foot so they can free the robe?" And you stare at the leg. And of course, if you think about that, anything happening like this, even today at that time, a woman would have slapped any man trying to do that. But if she didn't do that, is that she knew that was the trick. I mean, it
and
was
she accepted the courting ritual.
Roles, these are roles. In a banquet, let's say, if you want to send a message, since the Romans wouldn't use forks, they didn't use spoons, they used knives, but no spoons or forks. So everything would come in the banquet in small pieces. So you would grab that, you would eat with the hands. And so, let's say, in a common dish, you would try to touch the finger of the other person, trying to caress her. That was one of the tricks. Or when a cup full of wine would pass by, try to put your lips in the place where she had was another message. Very stupid things like this. Even more things, like you would like to send a message to her, well, you could write into specific, special tablets, on wax tablets, messages, but they could be like intercepted by husbands. So the good thing, a good suggestion was to write something on the skin of a slave to send her. And then there is another thing which is funny, is that Ovidio said, look, you can read all the suggestions to women and to men. And the main suggestion that he gives to women is to say, look, even if it's your lover, just keep in mind that love can just fade away if you don't try, if you don't, let's say, act somehow. How? Don't give yourself too easily and too often. Just be like very precious. So you already had the excuse of the addict. That's something.
Addict, yeah.
Yeah. Or other things like, no, today is my God's day. I cannot do anything as well. But then he would say, look, you must make your man really work hard for you. So one thing would be, one time, even if it's your lover and he's a clandestine, I mean, he comes into your home, right? Because a woman couldn't go around, and there were no motels or nothing. The only things she could do was in her home, especially if she was from a healthy family. So her lover would come by. Who would be the lover? Would be a family's friend, husband, friend, a neighbor, that was usually, sometimes even a slave. So he would come, and by the front door, of course, you had the collaboration of the slaves in home, because no one could really get into the house without being noticed. So there was kind of, there was some kind of collaboration. So anyway, don't tell him that he can come through the front door. Tell him that there's a problem, and he has to go up the walls are getting into the window just like a thief. And this poor guy had go on. They would go down, they would meet, they would close the door, meet on the bed, and then he said, at that time, just do another thing. Just make your personal slave coming. Say, hey, the husband is coming back. So where could that poor guy hide? Well, the only thing they had in the room was a wooden box for, let's say, the clothing. So he had to hide there. So that's what Ovidio said. And of course, he said, and you're laughing there with your slave because it's doing a trick. And then you tell me, of course. But we know other texts saying, written by men, saying, I'm fed up with hiding with those
in
wooden
trunk.
Boxes. With my head, my legs and my heart is pumping. So it was like something very cool.
I think we have a little time for questions. If you have any question for Alberto Angela, yes?
I think people get way too much of their information about history from movies. However, sometimes movies can be great art. What do you think of Fellini's attempt to deal with ancient Rome in Satyricon, which in a sense is exactly the same story that he dealt with in La Dolce Vita? Beautiful young Roman makes his way through every level of society. Satyricon is always presented as, it's in fragments, but it's a satire. In order to satire something, you have to have an outer reality of, and this was excess, a reality of excess. Fellini came out of a tradition of neorealism, but when he tried to make a movie about ancient Rome, he thought the only way you could present it, because you're dealing with 2,000 years now of Judeo-Roman, Judeo-Christian tradition, is to make it into a science fiction film, a science fiction going into the past rather than into the future. How do you feel about his attempt to deal with the Roman society? And
you also have to think about the time when he did the movie, of course, when he produced and directed the movie, which is different from today's, although it's still, let's say, after the war, so with a dynamic society. I would say that Fellini is the proof that you can find yourself very, very familiar with the Roman way of it. What he did was, he, you know, if you think about that time, you had a lot of movies about the past, ancient times. That was a time when you had a lot of B-movie, we would say, about that. So people were kind of the peplum area of movies. If you think also about Ben-Hur, the whole area of, in these years, you had this, many movies talking about, explaining that this word that has always attracted people. Now, his approach is his own approach, we know Fellini, but he was saying something interesting. He was saying, as I see the things, look, this world is not that far away from us. We have to do, as you said, a science fiction movie. But what I can, even though you see as Fellini would show the things even a little bit extreme, you would have a world that was new for the Rome, for the people. In not too, in almost the same period, you had Montanelli who was writing the story of Rome. So you had that approach, and I guess that Fellini tells you something that I went into. When I wrote the first book, I didn't expect the book to have, I mean, it was something I really wanted to write, so I made it for myself almost, but to set, to tell people what I have seen, discovered, and what usually the archaeology books don't tell you. But I saw that the reaction of people was a very intriguing, I mean, they were very intrigued and willing to know what was life and people at that time. And I wonder, say, why people are so attracted by the Roman times? Well, they say, well, you know, it's famous civilization. You have a lot of temples, columns. You have legions. You have emperors. I mean, it's a big civilization. I say, yes, but even pharaohs, the Greeks, Maya, ancient Chinese. I mean, they are the same. Why are people so attracted by Roman? And I realized that probably the main reason is that we find in the Romans the roots of our way of thinking, behaving, even the characters you use in the computers are the Roman ones, not the Greek ones. So you find yourself at home. But if you come to Rome, if you go to Pompeii, if you read a book about Roman times, it's just as if you had gone back to your grandfather's home, and going in the cellar, you would have found a trunk, as a place. You would open it, and you would find the old pictures of the family, let's say, the dresses of grandmother when she, let's say, married and so on. I guess that the question is, why are we so attracted by the Roman times? It's just because it's ourself in the past. We feel we're directly connected, not only genetically, but the way we feel. The way
and Alberto, when we say we, you don't spoke only about, you're not speaking only about the Italians, no, but about the Western world in general.
The book about the Romans had been translated in almost 10 languages, and I was presenting it in Moscow 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and I could ask myself, I said, people don't know me in Moscow, in Russia. They don't see my programs, they don't know who I am. Even the Roman Empire is somehow a little bit far away from, say, Moscow. Not really, because then I realized that the Russian called Moscow the Third Rome, because you had Rome, then it collapsed, then you had Constantinople, then it collapsed, and then you had a tradition that went to Moscow. That's why they called themselves the Romans, in a way. But when I saw these people lining up, and I had to write, I didn't know how even what to write in Russian. But and people, common people in the library, and I say there must be something. I cannot really understand. Then I start to think, and I say, why is an inhabitant, someone who lives in Moscow, who maybe is a truck driver, why does he want to buy my book and read the book about Rome? The only thing is that it is the way he finds his roots. Even a Japanese coming to Rome to see the Colosseum, and it's the same thing. In this book, what I did is that I found so many things we know, but in their time, I was impressed. If you want to understand our society, you read the book or other books like this, and you see so many common things that we have, and their solutions, and their way of acting, that's impressive. So, Moisa, I don't know if I answered your question.
Yeah, one.
No, I happen to be reading a novel about ancient Rome, and they're talking about the difference between the patricians and the plebeians. Was that the case when your book takes place?
Absolutely. This book shows you Rome and Roman times at its peak. Really. I make an example. You know that Nero or Julius Caesar or Augustus had never seen the Colosseum. It was not there yet. I mean, all what you see in the movies was after Nero. Let's say across the end of the first century, the beginning of the second, which is 80 years after Christ and 120 after Christ. That is more or less until Adrian's time, that is when you would have Roman at its peak, and it looked like New York, exactly the same. A melting pot, different languages, different people, but and then those skyscrapers. I imagine people getting to Rome and say, oh, look at that, how can people live in those, you know, in the rest of the empire, houses were 2-3 stories high, not more than that. London was made of wood, it looks like a Far West movie. And then you would have, oh well, yes, in the book I also, you discover many things by going to London, other places. You understand, for instance, that the French did not invent champagne, Romans did, and even the umbrella. It comes from ombra, which means shadow in Latin. So it was just like in the 17th century, only to shadow yourself from the sun. The Romans would use poncho. The same ponchos, you see some statues with the poncho you see today, they were using that. And another thing, in London, you would have those prefabricated houses. That's impressive. You would have the workers coming with some wood frames, and they would set up the house this way, very quick. And they would, of course, set up, you see, in other places. And so, in the houses, but in the houses, you would have things you already know. If I ask you, when you open the door of your house, which way is it? Is it going outside or inside your house? You say, inside my house. Well, that comes from the Roman Empire, because I say, if you open the house with the door outside, you're using the public area for your own purpose. That's why you have to open inside. Well, today you have also some safety reasons that you have to push the handle open, but usually the house, your house is made this way. The Greek didn't have that. The Greek could open the door inside or outside. So you were walking in an alley and you would have bang. So that's why it was a good manner in Greek time to knock the door to get inside or to go outside. So yeah. The Romans, if you would go to London or in other places, of course, and you would see someone arguing, you would see the middle finger raise up already. I mean, many things we feel like today's, you know, small fragments of life, good or bad, are very ancient. I remember, I think, this perspective. We have filmed papyrus dating back from Egypt times, I guess 3,500, or I don't remember the date, but it was during the Pharaoh's times, and it was written by a man who was probably someone not very young, pretty old, and he couldn't stand the youngsters. He would say, I cannot stand these young people going around in the alleys whistling Assyrian songs, which, you know, you say, hey man, you don't know, but here, come to our words and you will see what is the problem. I mean, but it's interesting to see that if you go back in time, you will see the same, because people are the same.
But were the plebeians allowed to intermarry with the patricians?
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't understand your question. I'm sorry. So, yes, during the Trajan time, you would have a hierarchy in the society, very strong. If you have to think about today's, India would give you a perspective that is, you have very rich, very poor, middle class, they cannot intermarry. You have people killing, you know, a young woman because she has a relationship with someone from a different layer. I mean, a different level. It's the same. In Roman time, you have the patrician, the rich, and which is not the same thing. Like an ex-slave could become very rich, but he was not allowed to go into, let's say, the patrician, the high society. So maybe he would have his daughter being married with someone, let's say, a patrician, who didn't have a lot of money, had a title, but not a lot of money. He was a noble, you know, getting into trouble. So they both would be happy because the noble would get the money and the other guy would have.
So intermarriage was allowed. Marriage in
only high society, only by people who had money, who had power. But then you had the lower society. What was life in lower society? We don't know exactly. All the historians of the ancient times and the ancient writers would tell you something about the high class, even that free society and free love and free sex society is really from the let's say the hotbar. But we understand that you have a middle class who tries to mimic the higher class. So they probably had the same rules, we know. And then you have the lower class. Lower class is amazing. I remember I've shown in films some skeletons from a graveyard of workers. They were poorer than the slaves, but they were citizens. They were free Romans, but they were poor, very poor. So it's interesting. We tend to think that in Roman society you had the rich who was Roman and the poor who was a slave. That's not a way. And then another thing that I was surprised and shocked about is that it was a polygamic society. A man could have many women. You had, a wife who was number one wife, and then you had a number two wife who didn't have very much power. I mean, you had like a hierarchy of women. We don't know exactly. We know that, for instance, it is interesting to see that in all the Roman cities, Rome, of course, Rome in the head, you didn't have, let's say, an area of rich people and then a poor area, let's say, downtown. No, everything was mixed. You would have a building full of poor people and then close, you would have the rich person. Everything was mixed. It's interesting. Today it's not like this. You didn't have Beverly Hills in Rome, but you had exclusive areas, especially let's say in the coast of Naples, where rich had their villas, and anything would happen there. Absolutely, I mean, we know that.
They went wild.
Wow.
One last question. Yes.
Ciao Alberto, buonasera. Thank you for being here, first of all, and share your deep knowledge. It's always a pleasure to listen to you and your father as well. I have actually two questions, but I'm sure they will be pretty short. One would be, what Romans would love and hate of America? What Romans would love and hate of America? And also, I would like to know what you don't like of Roman people.
Let me answer first. The first question is, they would feel very familiar. There would be very few things they would hate from, let's say, the United States, or let's say Western civilization, we can say as a whole. Very few things. Probably they would, a Roman would hate the fact that women in our society are more free. They can, if you go to Europe, Merkel or Thatcher or other, you have women in power. That was something a Roman would not understand. I mean, in a common, in ordinary life, they, but you would have women in power, but not in the government of a country. No, this is something a Roman would not understand. Other things, the fact that he would hate the fact that we don't have slaves. He would not hate that. He would not understand that. Which is, but if you think slaves were here, I mean, in our societies, in our, until very recently, and in many places in the world today, you have slaves still. So, he would love, okay, there is one thing he wouldn't like at all. So, imagine to take out for dinner a Roman. That was embarrassing. Well, you would take in a good restaurant, Italian restaurant maybe, since it's in New York. He would eat with his hands. He would burp. He would see the waitress and say he would try to assault the waitress. Yes, that would be going out with a Roman male. yes, because in Roman times, if you would go into a so-called restaurant, you didn't have restaurants. You had, I guess,
Taberna,
yes, it's just like places. Imagine a saloon, you know, in the movies. That's more or less the idea. And in a saloon, you have prostitutes, right? Usually you have a stairs. That's what you see in the movies. Well, the same would happen in Austria or Rome. Any woman working in a place where you eat would be a prostitute as well. Even the owner, if she was a woman, you would ask her to go and have sex with her. That was absolutely normal. So, you see, a Roman would be kind of an embarrassing person to take out of so, but he would love many things. He would love to be in a society that is dominating, a society strong, a society that has rules, a society where people believe in the rules. Because the Roman Empire fell because people were not believing the rules in a way of thinking. Just imagine Julius Caesar. He was like, technically speaking, there were a bunch of people with skirts, sandals. they conquered Europe, you know, defeating very strong tribes. Why? Because it's just like a small dog being very aggressive. He really impressed even a big dog. It's the same. Romans were sure to be the strongest. They had a fantastic society behind them. They were professional soldiers. They would meet people who were not professional, who were stronger, but were not organized. They were just like human ants. I mean, they were very organized. If you watch the movie The Gladiator and you see the battle at the beginning, it's perfect. You see exactly what happened. The commander, you know, makes a speech to the troops, and then you have first the artillery hitting the enemy, and then you have the soldiers going,
infantry
organized just as a chess game. And then the cavalry taking the sides, just perfect. What is wrong there are some small details, I don't know why, so the elements are totally wrong, but it's fine, I mean, it's okay.
Alberto, one last thing that came from the question. What is it that you do not like about the Romans?
Okay, I get to the point. Slaves, pedophilia, which is most common. I wouldn't have liked to live in that time because any problems, any physical problem I had to go through the hands of a surgery of a doctor who was good, but they didn't have anesthetics or something like that. They even have small gods, you know. They would treat you and they would say, have a small god there and say, what do I know, you know. they didn't know what bacteria were, so they didn't know what to do. They knew infections, but didn't know the origin of infection. Another thing, but I would have liked to go into the Roman time. Of course, for all the times, if you want to see, to live with Michelangelo, if you want to live in the medieval ages, be a rich person. Because if you're a poor person, you know, like, because, you know, this is very common. I would like to live the same, okay. Try to be a slave, and then that's a different problem. So, what I like in the Roman time, probably, is what was here. It was the fact that they knew they were building a society who was a strong society, and it was a society for everyone, of course, as long as you were a Roman. And you probably know that you were on the right beam. As we feel today, we feel that our society is have a lot of problems, probably the mistakes, but we know that we feel very well in our way of living. We went to the moon. We discovered many things as a research, scientific research. We know that this society allows you to understand your place in the world, in the universe. I think that what I like in the Roman time is that really that idea of being very practical. Other civilizations were more philosophical, more let's say if you go to the even in Pharaoh's times, you would have the Pharaoh, the caste, let's say the level of the let's say higher society, and then the rest were peasants. But if you go in the Roman times in Egypt, you would have Alexandria with one of the highest libraries made by the Greek times, of course, but it was going on. You would have people, tourists in the tombs. I would have liked that time because that would make me understand for the first time in human history my place in the world. Yes, they believed in gods, but they knew the practical world and how to solve it. Let me tell you one thing is Rome had 11 aqueducts, which is 1 billion of running liters of running water every day. We were able in Italy to do that only starting from the 70s, that is a few decades ago. But since we are the double of people living in Rome, they had the double of water, maybe related. And anywhere you go in Europe, when you travel with a car, you're traveling probably on a Roman road. That's been paved. I mean, it has been traced by the Romans. Many cities were really literally invented by Romans. London, Paris were invented by the Romans for different reasons. Mainly for the market reason, because it was a good place to sell, to ship things, and to sell them in the land. So I would find everything practical. If you feel that the body of laws, we still use the body of laws of the Roman times, which is amazing. So if you watch all this, even look, and I finish, is that I feel very home with them. I feel familiar with all the things they do. Why? As an Italian, of course, but in the States it's the same. You feel like you like life, you like the good food, you like the good dresses, you like entertainment a lot. Tell me. That's exactly the Romans. We are the Romans of today. Absolutely. That's why we feel.
Well, I thank Alberto Angela for having brought back to life the Roman times. Again, his book follows the story of this coin traveling from hand to hand to the outer limits of the empire, back to Rome, and then out again. And through the story of this coin, you read the stories of the people. And there are the people that are normally mentioned in history books. And as he mentioned, there are also the stories of the people that might have a name, but that are never mentioned in history books. And for this, we are very grateful. And I invite you to read Alberto Angela's book, The Ritual of Rome. Thank you.